Are you thanking Jesus like that?
Jesus.
The one who is going to perform that miracle. You are just thanking him like that. Come on, tell him thank you. Thank him for what he said to do. Thank him for what he said to do. Thank him for what he said to do. What a faithful God we serve. Someone is about to receive their deliverance right now. Someone is about to receive a miracle right now. Thank him. Thank him. Call him names. You are a dependable God. You are a good God. Thank him because you are not sick. Thank him because you are not downcast. Thank him because you are not dead. Thank him because you are not in the hospital. Thank him because you are not in the mortuary. Celebrate the King of Kings. Celebrate the Lord of Lords. The Lion of the tribe of Judah. Oh, Father, we love you. Merciful God, we love you. Merciful God, we love you. Merciful God, we love you. The God in whom we live, we act, we walk, and we have our being. The God who colored us things that be not as though they are. Thank him. Thank him. We adore you, El Shaddai. We worship you, Elohim. Jehovah Rofika, the God of healing, we thank you. Jehovah Nisi, we thank you. Jehovah Makadesh, we thank you. Yeshua and Mashiach, we thank you. The God that goes to battles and coming back with the head of champions, we thank you. Dependable God, we thank you. Reliable God, we thank you. Thank you and thank you, my Father. Who else can be like you, Jesus? Who else can be like you, Savior? Thank you, Father. Thank you, Master Jesus. Thank you, Master Jesus. Thank you, Master Jesus. We bless your holy name. In Jesus' mighty name we are praying.
Amen.
Happy Father's Day to all the fathers in the house. Hallelujah.
Amen.
If you are a father, shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
If you are online, write hallelujah. Glory hallelujah. To God. What a privilege. I pray for every father in the house in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. I declare this year is your year of open doors in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Every father in the house, I declare the rest of your days, the rest of this year, you will live in prosperity in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
You will live in abundance in the name of
Amen.
Jesus. Be empowered to be the best father in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you, my Father. In Jesus' name we are praying. Hallelujah. Now it's time for our offering. Please get out your offering. If you have been giving, well, you give online. What you do is, as a point of contact, you put your hand on your chest. If you have been giving online, just as a point of contact to what we are doing here. We have the account details here of everyone that has given so far. So if you are part of them, please just put your hand on your chest as a point of contact as I release a blessing. It shall be one word. Father, in the name of Jesus, bless them, Lord. Abraham called his servant and gave them gifts, but he called his son and gave him the blessing. Let the blessing of the Lord locate you now in the mighty name of
Amen.
Jesus. Let the blessings of the Lord locate you now in the name
Amen.
Of Jesus. Someone here this week, I pray for supernatural finances in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Let finances be released to you in unexpected quarters in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
That one that abuse you, that mock you, may they celebrate you this week in the name of
Amen.
Jesus. You may have been rejected before, but by your offering, by your seed, by your tithe, by your kingdom investment, I pray for new testimonies in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I pray for new testimonies in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I pray for a new story in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I pray for a new anointing in the name of
Amen.
Jesus. May that be your story after
yes,
now
Lord,
in
Lord,
Jesus' name. Amen. Thank God if you believe that. Thank you. Father, we just thank
Lord,
you.
Thank you.
Lord, we
thank
just celebrate you.
Jesus.
Thank you because we know
you
have answered.
Yes,
we love you, Master
Lord,
Jesus.
We
love you, Master
we
Jesus.
You,
we love you, Master
we
Jesus.
You
alone are worthy, Jesus.
You
alone are worthy, Jesus.
You
alone are worthy, Jesus. We adore you, Master Jesus. We celebrate you, Master Jesus. Thank you and thank you and thank you. In Jesus' name we have prayed.
Amen.
Please like and share and do a watch party if you have to. Like I said, this is the way in which others are blessed, and that's the way in which you also, you are preaching the word of God unknowingly. And everyone that preaches the word of God, the Bible says that his feet shall be shining. His feet shall be shining. There'll be light on his feet. Hallelujah. So I declare as you share, may God honor you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
May God honor someone online in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I want us to pray one prayer and then we'll go straight to our message. Father, We just thank you for today. We thank you for this afternoon. Merciful Jesus, full of mercy, help me again today, Lord. Let your mercy speak for them this afternoon as your word goes forth in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for your son, Jesus Christ, who is seated above all principalities and powers in the mighty name of Jesus. Oh, Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I ask today as your word goes forth, open our hearts to hear and receive your everlasting word and fill us with your spirit. Fill us with your truth. Fill us with your power. Fill us with wisdom in the name of Jesus. Sweet Holy Ghost, as the word goes forth now, let every power and yoke of wickedness that has stared us in the face all this year, let it be destroyed in the name of Jesus. Let every Goliath still standing go down in the name of Jesus. Let there be financial recovery, oh Lord. Let there be material recovery, oh Lord. Let there be marital recoveries, oh Lord. Let there be a restoration in every area of their lives. In Jesus' mighty name we are praying. Amen. I just want to give some few testimonies this week. Anyways, a few testimonies before I take one prayer. A few testimonies. Someone said immigration breakthrough. Someone said there are numerous healing. But one of the healing that I'm so shocked with a gentleman from London who is watching us right now, I believe, said he has been going through a lot of affliction for many years. Every time he closes his eyes, there's someone comes and afflicts him in the dream. It's either he eats in his dream, or he's having sex in the dream, or familiar spirits, or he sees himself back home, all sort of dreams. But by a word, 4 weeks from now, he has not had any of those dreams. Amen. He was totally set free by the hand of God. I don't know what you are going through. All it takes is a belief system. I declare by the power of the Holy Ghost, every dream manipulation, every altar in your father's house, in your mother's house, that is fired in your dreams to delay your testimony, to make you fail at the age of miracle, by this word, that altar catches fire in the name of Jesus. That altar catches fire in the name of Jesus. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. If he did it for me, if he did it for that young gentleman, he can do it for you. May you testify in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
May you testify in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
The Bible says you shall lie down and your sleep shall be sweet for the glory of God. From this encounter, let your sleep be sweet to the glory of God.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus
Amen.
Christ. Thank you, my Father. Our brother said he had a case. One of our brothers just said he had a case at his job site. This is a good job, he said. And they accused him falsely. And if normally he was acquitted for that particular case, he would have lost his job and would have had a thing on the CRB. I don't know how you call that. A criminal record on the CRB, and it would have been difficult for him to get another job. But by the hand of God, the case was dropped and he's free. I don't know who is accusing you, the accuser of the brethren. Whoever has vowed that job, you will not keep it. Whoever has vowed that wife, you will not keep it. Whoever has vowed that husband, you will not keep it. Whoever has vowed that you will not move forward. By this encounter, I project myself on those altars and I set them on fire in the name of Jesus. I set them on fire in the name of Jesus. Whoever is standing on your marriage, I command them to catch fire in the name of Jesus. Whoever is sitting on your finances, I command them to release it in the name of Jesus. Thank you, my Father. Another testimony that is most striking is our brother said that last week a word was released that someone was going to receive a call, and that he received a call that same day. That was on Sunday, and things turned around from his school. Even some monies that he has worked that they refused to pay him, that they released it to him by the power of the Holy Ghost. He's the same yesterday, today, forever.
Yes,
I declare, wherever you are old, let that one that owe you lose sleep now until they give you your money in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Whatever it is that they owe you by this encounter, may they lose sleep until they give it to you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you, my Father. And I don't just mean give it to you. I mean double for your trouble in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Double for your trouble in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you, my Father, for perfecting these testimonies. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed.
Amen.
Amen. We seal all the testimonies in the blood of Jesus, in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Please don't be offended if we did not call your testimony. It is because we are waiting for the lockdown so that you can share your testimonies yourself on that altar. And it will be a testimony and celebration service.
Amen.
I cannot wait for that day.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I cannot wait for that day. 2 Kings 1:10. Thank you, my Father. Holy Ghost, mercy. 2 Kings 1:10. It says, prophet Elijah called down fire to consume his enemies. Listen to that. Some of you say, I don't have enemies. Oh, you don't know the Bible. Prophet Elijah, a prophet of God, called down fire to consume his enemies. Verse 10 says, and Elijah answered and said to the captain of 50, if I be a man of God, then let fire come down from heaven and consume thee and the 50. And there came down fire from heaven and consumed him and his 50. His enemies came against him. But you will say, I will preach love to the enemy. There's a time to preach love and there's a time to release fire. I want us to pray, Oh Lord Jesus, release upon my tongue now.
As I pray,
a judgmental anointing. Put your hand on your tongue. Release on my tongue now. A judgmental anointing. It is falling on someone now in the name of Jesus. Pray that prayer. Release on my tongue now a judgmental anointing to set the enemies of my life on fire. Release on my tongue now some judgmental anointing. You set the enemies of my life on fire. The enemies of my job. The enemies of my finances. Release on my tongue. A judgment anointing. You set them on fire. Makokote. Are you praying that prayer? Let him hear your voice. Pray that prayer. Let me hear your voice. Release on my tongue a judgment anointing. As I release fire now in the camp of my enemy, let literal fire come down and begin to consume them. Those satanic pots, those satanic altars, those arrows that they have fired against any area of my life, let the fire of God consume them. Let the fire of God consume them. Thank you, my Father. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Please take your Bibles if at all you know where they are. Hallelujah. Take your Bibles. Let's start this word. It will be a very short word. The assignment I have today, the mandate I have today is to pray. God said, let my people pray in this service. You are praying not just for yourself. When I say pray, don't act like a professor. When I say pray, I mean pray. Don't act like a head teacher or a headmistress. When I say pray, I mean pray. God said, as they pray, I will come down and answer them.
Yes.
If my people that are called by my name humble themselves and pray, so shall I hear from heaven. Amen. And my ears shall be attentive unto that prayer that is done in this place today. And he said, I'll come down and answer them.
Yes.
So as you pray today, that is what will answer for you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Quickly, I want us to continue with the series we started this month on My Goliath Must Die. Now, Goliath are dying left, right, center. This is a very sensitive topic.
Amen.
Hallelujah. This is a very sensitive place. Hallelujah. We are not announcing it because it's sensitive for some of us. Hallelujah. I want you to continue. I want to continue the series we started this month on My Goliath Must Die. Now, today's service, I don't know, this is not what I wanted to preach, but this is what I've been giving. It's more of an advice, and we'll pray like never before. If you come to my office for counseling, I do three things. I'll say two of them. The first thing I do is pray for you. And the second thing I do is advise and give you a counsel. You and your couple, your spouse. So today is more of an advice. I have prayed for you. Today is more of an advice. And next week, Sunday, we shall handle those whom the Goliath of our families may have directed the baton to. You know where runners are running? These relay races. They give the baton to someone behind them. In every family, child of God, if there's a witch in that family, if he dies now, before he dies, he always has someone who he is training, who he will transfer the baton to. That's why even when the Goliath dies in many families, you'll see the affliction still continues. You know why? Because he has transferred the baton to someone else who will continue to fight you. So next Sunday is a prophetic service. We will roast everyone that the baton has been transferred to in the mighty name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Today is more than advice, and I have titled this short word, The Stone That Killed My Goliath. Now your Goliath are still not alive. For those of your Goliath who have refused to repent and still alive, I tell you this by the power of the Holy Ghost, they have been chained, they have been caged till the coming of Christ.
Amen.
So they are powerless. They don't have any access to you again.
Amen.
Hallelujah. The stone that killed my Goliath. Our verses for meditation is the same as last week and last 2 weeks. 1 Samuel 17, 40 to 51. 1 Samuel 17, 40 to 51. Those are the same verses literally. And David put his hand. I'm trying so much today not to hurry. I'm trying because I said it's an advice today. So I'm trying so much not to hurry. It's not more of warfare in this preaching. Warfare is at the end when we're about to pray. Our verses, 1 Samuel 17, 40 to 51. 49, I read from verse 49. And David put his hand in his bag and took then a stone and slung it and smote Goliath in his forehead, that the stone sunk into his forehead and he fell upon. I've never heard that a stone can sunk into someone's forehead. That is to tell you that it was prophetic. That is to tell you that the hand of the Lord went with that stone, sir. The hand of the Lord went with that stone. It says in verse 51, therefore David ran and stood on Goliath. Look at that. David ran and stood on Goliath. To defeat your Goliath, you must stand on them in prayers.
Amen.
And just in case you watching me now, you are saying you don't have a strong man or a Goliath in your family. Well, your Goliath anyway might be bitterness. Your Goliath anyway might be anger. Your Goliath anyway might be jealousy. Your Goliath anyway might be backbiting. Your Goliath anyway might be unforgiveness, because these are some of the things that will stop you from entering into your next level. Your Goliath may not be a physical strong man. Your Goliath may be that bad habit, pornography, masturbation, loss of the eyes, loss of the flesh, vainglory. Your Goliath may be bitterness, hatred, jealousy. That may be your Goliath. So if you say you don't have a physical strong man, you have to sit on bitterness. You have to sit on backbiting. You have to sit on lies telling. Some people, they cannot control themselves from telling lies. Something in them just wants them to tell lies. Something in them just wants them to be jealous of others. Something in them just wants them to be angry with people anyhow. Look, that may be your Goliath. And today I want you to arise by the power of the Holy Ghost and say, enough is enough. You must sit on these things. And the Bible says in the same verses 51, and took his sword. After he sat, he stood on Goliath. What did he do? He took his sword. Remember, the sword speaks of the word of God. And drew it out of his shield thereof and slain Goliath and cut off his head. So the word of God can cut off your enemy's head, sir.
Amen.
The word of God can cut off your enemy. Remember, the Bible says the word is like a two-edged, my God, breaking asunder spirit and marrow, joints, everything it meets, it cuts into two. As you pray today, that word that comes out of your mouth, it shall cut your enemies into pieces in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
It shall cut your enemies into pieces in the name,
amen,
of Jesus. Thank you, my Father.
Thank you, Jesus.
Now, quickly, child of God, be very attentive. I have said every time we release a declaration here, there are testimonies. Every time.
Amen.
Every time. But that always happens,
amen,
to those who are attentive. Most of those testimonies you hear are from declarations that have been released, not literally prayer. Are from declaration. So be attentive today, because something will happen in your family. I said once, I said a particular Sunday, I said, I'll call someone, I said, your strong man is gone. And that happened. I will say that again today. If you are attentive and you want to move forward in life, every Goliath in your family that has vowed that you will not move forward, by this service today, they will call you and tell you of their death in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Now quickly, child of God, we had already established the fact that battles are real. Battles of life are real. We said that in life and destiny, there is no such thing as accidental success. There is no such thing as accidental success, because nobody becomes rich by mistake. We have established already that the battles of life are inevitable. If it is not this, it is that. If it is not that, it is this. If it is not this, and it is grace that takes you, that puts you, that gives you stamina. It is a grace of God that gives you stamina, audacity to stand in the midst of battles and say, I have the victory. The grace of God. That grace is falling on someone now in the mighty name of Jesus. That grace is falling on someone now in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Child of God, as long as you are on earth and you are alive, you will have to fight battles. I know this is not the word you want to hear. And you don't need to do anything wrong to anybody. There are people that just looking at you, you are pregnant, they will not want you to deliver. There are people that just looking at you, you have a job, they will not want you to sit in that office. There are people that just looking at you, you have a husband, they will not want you to enjoy that husband. There are people that just looking at you, you have something that they don't have. Jealousy sets in and witchcraft sets in. That one is meant to be terminated today. Whoever is fighting you from any satanic altar, whoever has taken your picture to any satanic altar, let the fire of God consume them in the name of Jesus. Let the fire of God consume them in the name of Jesus. Let the fire of God consume them in the name of Jesus. Whoever has found that your children will not move forward, that your children will give you problems, let that altar scatter in the name of Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, my Father.
Thank you, Holy Ghost.
Last week, I see the glory of God on top of roofs. You watching me online,
amen.
I see the glory of God on top of your roofs.
Amen.
You watching me online, I see the glory of God on top of your roofs.
Amen.
Last week we said that no one just succeeds in the kingdom without a fight. No one defeats their Goliath without a fight. No one succeeds in this kingdom without a fight. We also said that in life and destiny, child of God, and in this kingdom, there are no shortcuts. There are no shortcuts. If you want lasting riches in this kingdom, there are no shortcuts. Because every man that made it big in this kingdom, Abraham, Jacob, Isaac, name them, they had to engage in constant warfare. And King David won every battle, including the battle against the biggest man that ever lived on earth, that's Goliath. Because David knew that the greatest strategy of life is not unanswered prayers, but it is unoffered prayers. It is unoffered prayers. The greatest strategy of life is not unanswered prayer, but it is unoffered prayer. And that is why the Bible says in 1 Thessalonians 5:17, pray without ceasing. Pray without ceasing. It's literally like saying drive without stopping. That's what it means. So everything you are doing, you are praying. You are in the toilet, you are praying. As you are eating, your mouth, you are eating and you are still praying. I pray in my thoughts. I pray in my deeds. I pray in my spirit. I pray at all times. I go and I pray everywhere I am. Some people say, I'm in a market so I cannot pray. What an error. It is foolishness to be shameful of things that are gainful. I don't know that a man of God said it. It is foolishness to be shameful of those things that are gainful to you. 1 Peter 5:8. Be sober. Be vigilant. Because what? Your adversaries, if you want, your enemies, the devil, as a, they did not say that you may have enemies, sir. It says your enemies. So he knows that it is there. There's no game saying the fact. You have enemies, child of God, whether you know it or not. And there's a time to love them. And there's a time to say, enough is enough. It says, be sober. Be vigilant. Because your enemy, the devil, as a roaring lion. You know what a lion is? He says, he walketh about, seeking whom to devour. If he comes to you, you're on fire. He goes to someone else who is not on fire. He seeks whom to devour every day. He roams around 24/7, seeking who to devour. So that tells you that in the journey of life, evil will continue to prevail when good men sit back and they do nothing about the battles of their life. Evil will continue to prevail in your life, in your family, and this is not a prophecy of doom. Evil will continue to prevail when good men sit back and they do nothing about the battles of their life. Whether you know it or not, the last time you did not pray, the last time you slept, in your days of ignorance, something was stolen from you. But I declare by this encounter, you will recover all in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I say restoration is coming to you in the name of Jesus.
Amen. I receive it.
Many people today will tell you that they are broke because they came from a poor family. No, sir. No, ma. You are not broke because you came from a poor family. You are broke because you refuse to confront the Goliath of your life. You refuse to confront the Goliath that is staring you in the face. You refuse to confront the Goliath that is tying your finances. How many people have I said here and say, I see your finances tie? Some of them are even anointing their hand and say, I see a hole in your finances. And after that, suddenly something happens. Finances are being released. Why? Because a strong man was stealing their finances. As a matter of fact, the brother whom I called, who gave a testimony today, one time he came here and I said, I see a hole in your hand. And he's the one that the finances are being released again now.
Amen.
So the devil is out to steal, to kill, and to destroy. So you must make up your mind. It is not the poor family you came from. No, sir, no, ma. It is because you have refused to confront the Goliath that has vowed that you will not prosper. What you must understand, child of God, is that it is an error. And many people who refuse to confront their Goliaths, what they mostly do is they begin to blame people for their failures. They begin to blame people for their failures. It is my mother that made me broke. It is my father that made me broke. It is my brother that made me broke. They don't love me. They love my, just like Joseph's brother was fighting him. Their brothers, instead of looking forward to see how they can confront their Goliath and begin to take what belongs to them, they were looking at his brother. They were jealous of his brother. They were angry with his brother. David was the same thing, sir. Where they came to anoint David, sir, David was not there. David was in the forest. In his family, he was relegated to the background. When David went to the battlefront, which I'll explain later on, to go and give them food, they say, "You, your wicked hand, what have you come to do here?" David heard his brother said that. We'll see that from the verses as we go on. So what you must understand is that it is an error to sit down there and put blame on other people for your failure. Failure really starts when you have someone you blame. My father says that. Failure really starts when you have someone to blame. Failure really starts when you have someone to blame. Look at Joseph, if you were a child of God. His brothers fell blatantly in life and destiny because they were angry with a dreamer. They were angry with a dreamer and they began to put blame on Joseph for their failure. So therefore, child of God, the brothers fell because they were approaching life and fighting battles with anger in their hearts, with bitterness in their heart, with hatred in their heart. And this was an offense as far as God is concerned. I don't know how you got that. Many of us, we go to the battlefront with anger. We go to the battlefront blaming others. We go to the battlefront with hatred for others. We go to the battlefront saying that we are where we are because someone made us like that. What happened to the man that sat at the pool for 38 years? He was there for 38 years because instead of confronting his Goliath, because there was a Goliath stopping him from entering there, whether you know it or not. Instead of confronting that Goliath, he was blaming everybody around him. I've been here for 38 years. Nobody cares about me. How would they care about you if they too have their own problem? And the rule was the first person to jump in there, he was the first person that was healed. Instead of fighting the strong man and the strong woman that was hindering him from just sleeping in that pool. He has been there for that long, so he knew exactly when the angel was coming. Sir, 38 years, you should know. A man of God said, "I'll just sleep in there." I'll just sleep in there. Because you know, you can estimate when that angel comes. But he forgot about that. And he began to blame everyone else. Even when the master came to him, he said, "Master, nobody cares about me." Master, the master asked him, "Do you want to be healed?" The answer would have been yes or no. But because he carried bitterness, anger with everyone around him in his heart. And I believe that's why he wasn't even healed. Because anger, bitterness, they could see him from promises that he wasn't happy. Nobody helps an unhappy person. Hallelujah. So therefore, the brothers fell because they were approaching life and fighting battles with anger, with bitterness, with hatred, and this was an offense before God, and that is why they did not prosper. They never prosper. Remember when they even came to see Joseph in the palace, when Joseph was already made the second in line. I believe Joseph was the first in line because he was taking care of everyone, including the first in line. When they came to see Joseph, Joseph could not recognize them, but they recognized Joseph. Joseph, they reversed. Sorry about that. When they came to see Joseph, what happened is Joseph could recognize them because they have not changed one bit. Hallelujah. Their anger was still there. Their bitterness was still there. And that was hindering them from moving forward. Joseph could recognize them, but they could not recognize Joseph. That is what happens when you are angry about your brother. That is what happens when you are angry about your sister. That is what happens when you are angry about your family members. That is what happens when you keep unforgiveness in your heart. Some of us think we are God. Say, "Me, I will never forgive you." It's like you are taking the place of God. Every time you allow unforgiveness in your heart, it is like a chain around your neck, friends. It is like a chain on your legs. It is like a chain on your hands, and it stops you from moving forward. That will not be your story in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Any unforgiveness in your heart, Lord, let your mercy wipe it off now in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Let your mercy wipe it off now in the name of
Amen.
Jesus. Child of God, many Christians in churches all over the world, They are fighting the battles of life with bitterness, with unforgiveness, with anger, with hatred, with jealousy, offending God. And they wonder why God is yet to answer some of their prayers. Ecclesiastes 10:8. He that diggeth a pit shall fall into it, and whosoever breaketh an hedge, a serpent will bite. Breaketh an hedge. When you carry unforgiveness, you break the hedge. When you carry bitterness, you break the hedge. When you carry any form of a bad character, you break the hedge. And God does not answer those sort of prayers except by the mercy of God. And when you still have people to blame for your failure, child of God, this will stop you from fighting your battles in the place of freedom. I have this to say, sir. You win battles in the place of the freedom that God has given you. You win battles in the place of the freedom that God has given you, sir. You must have a free spirit. You must, your heart must be free for you to be able to win battles. You win battles on the liberty that Christ has already given to you. Galatians 5:1. Regarde. He says, stand fast therefore in the liberty. Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ has made us free, and be not entangled again with a yoke of bondage. And whether you know it or not, unforgiveness is a yoke of bondage. Bitterness is a yoke of bondage. Jealousy is a yoke of bondage. Lies telling is a yoke of bondage. Backbiting is a yoke of bondage. Hatred is a yoke of bondage. Stand firm, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ has made us free. That is where you win battles. To defeat your Goliath, child of God, and win every battle, you must stand in the liberty, or the freedom, if you want, that Christ has already set for you. Freedom from unforgiveness. Freedom from lies telling. Freedom from loss of the eyes, loss of the flesh. Freedom from bitterness. Freedom from jealousy. Freedom from complaints. Because where you stand to fight any battle, child of God, determines what you conquer. Where you stand to fight any battle in life determines what you conquered. Where the children of Israel, the armies of Israel stood with all the armors, with all the best weapons, was not where David stood. Where they stood was not where David stood. They stood in a place of hiding. They stood in a place of fear. But David stood in a place of safety. David stood in a place of freedom. David stood in a place of liberty. Where you stand to fight your Goliath determines what you recover, determines what you conquer, determines the speed at which you conquer.
Amen.
After now, it shall be said of you, speed in every area of your life in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Speed in every area of your life in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Someone here, you have been rejected last week. This week, they will call you and give you what you deserve.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus. I said they will call you and give you what you deserve in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Right now, I see a migration breakthrough. If you have been rejected before, take your breakthrough in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Take your financial miracle in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Take your immigration breakthrough in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Wherever you have been delayed, I put a speed to your feet in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I put wings behind your back in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Child of God, where you stand to fight any battles determine if you will be outstanding or not. Jesus, our Messiah, rightfully so, if you want, could have blamed those he came to die for, who literally turned around and said, kill him. Who literally turned around and said, persecute him. Who literally turned around and said, we don't like him. But our master said in Luke 23:34, say, forgive them, O Lord, for they know not what they are doing. Look at David, if you will. What about David? Who was relegated to the background, I've said this already, even by his own parents, even by his own brothers, and who also refused to blame his brothers for failing, to blame his brothers for failing to confront Goliath. He got to the battlefront and his focus was on Goliath. His focus was on the end of Goliath. As far as David was concerned, Goliath was already dead.
Amen.
Think about it, if you like, for a second. When boxers, sir, when they go to the ring to fight, they don't think about the last boxing match they failed. They don't think about the faith. They don't think about anything except that I will knock him down in the first round. I will knock him down. They see the end of the thing. They see the end of it. They are focused on victory. They are focused on knocking him down. They are focused on moving, and they are focused on the crown. They are focused on the belt. They are focused on the reward of that boxing match. So why David's brother, child of God, stood there looking at the vastness and the grandeur of Goliath. David, as a result, on the other side, saw what? The reward. They were looking at the grandeur, the biggest man on earth. They were saying probably to themselves, I have never seen such a man before. I have never seen such a giant before. They were looking at the bigness, the grandeur of Goliath. But David was focused on the reward. So child of God, stop hoping that someday, that somehow, that everything will be all right without doing anything about it. I do not know about you, but I've learned, I said that last week, that to recover any lasting thing, any permanent thing in this generation, in this kingdom, you must make up your mind, rightfully so, to put on your weapon of warfare and confront that challenge that is standing in front of you, and confront that Goliath that has been staring you in the face all these years. And I don't mean on some days, I mean every day of your life. I said to someone who was afraid of the dark once that to confront that phobia, you must go towards what is scaring you, sir. To confront darkness, you must go towards darkness. To confront fear, you must do those things that make you afraid. To confront poverty, you must do that thing, those things that make you feel like you're broke. You must begin to take risks. You must begin to take steps. You must forge ahead with greater speed and more focus to begin to confront those things that have ever made you afraid. The Bible says, while the armies of Israel were afraid to face Goliath, David went towards Goliath. While the armies of Israel were afraid to face Goliath, David went towards Goliath, not the reverse. He went towards Goliath. Why was David not afraid? Because David could see what they could not see. I come back to this because spiritual dullness and blindness has put a lot of people in bondage. So I'll talk about that again for a bit. Look at what the Bible says in 1 Samuel 17:40. And he took his staff in his hand and choosing 5 smooth stones out of a brook and put them in the shepherd's bag, which he had, even in the scrip. And his sling was in his hand, and he drew near to Goliath. He drew near to Goliath. Look at it. Goliath did not draw near. He drew near to Goliath. The guy was not afraid. The guy was not afraid. He has seen the end of Goliath. Whatever makes you afraid, that is what you should confront. That is what you should go to. And we said last week that the miracle stone that was needed to kill Goliath was close to the armies of Israel, but they could not see it for 40 days and 40 nights, and one non-entity that was not even circumcised was oppressing them. Why? Because their eyes were open, were closed. Oh Lord, open my eyes. The stone was there all along, but they were hiding from one man because of spiritual dullness, because of spiritual blindness. And we said last week that if your Goliath must be exposed and go down, your spiritual eyes, child of God, must be open. And so what you see in the realm of the spirit determines what you get in the physical. What you see in the realm of the spirit determines what you get in the physical. Every day I come to church, I see 1 million people. I don't know how. I feel like I'm walking in between 1 million people. I don't care what you think. That is what I see. Do we have 1 million people here? No, sir. No, ma. But what you see in the realm of the spirit determines what you recover in the physical. And hear me well, child of God. Many fleshly Christians, churchgoer, religious Christian, they think, for example, I've said it so many times, that marriage is all about beauty. That marriage is all about how you dress. That all that is good. But they think that the soul, the main thing that will give you a husband is your beauty. That the main thing that will give you a husband is the way you look, is the way you dress. And you see them laying foundations on their face, foundation upon foundation, one foundation to another. Don't lay one foundation, don't wire it. Lay another foundation, wire it. Lay another foundation. It's like they are building a house on their faces because they think that marriage comes from looks. They think that marriage comes from look. They think that foundation is what will bring you a husband. But they forget that real men in the first place will normally go for natural looks. The truth, child of God, is that a man who gets married to you because of your makeup, I said this to someone the other day, a man who gets married to you because of your makeup or how you look will always cheat on you 90% of the time, or even leave you when they see another woman with a better makeup, or they leave you when they see you without a makeup. Myself and Pastor David, I don't know Pastor David, last week after the service, I saw a picture on Facebook, I don't know if it's you I showed, where I saw a girl before her makeup and after her makeup. Before her makeup, I'm sorry, before her makeup, and now I don't mean to be abusive, I'm just saying a fact here. Before that makeup, I doubt what would have happened. But after the makeup, you could see a transformation. Even me, I could look at her and say, you are so beautiful, if I met her. But before the makeup, I'll probably pass and say, hi, have a nice day. But after the makeup, someone wrote a caption there and said, this is fraud. Say, this is fraud. Child of God, what brings a real husband is not that you arrest and package your breasts. It's not that you expose them. It's not that you make your bum bum big. Because if that was the case, then our parents would probably never have gotten married in their days, where they had no better clothes. Remember, in those days, what women wore mostly was wrappers. They'll take wrappers and tie on their chest, and you'll see a man hanging in the bushes and blowing whistles or shooting stones on the roof just for that woman with a wrapper to come and say, I love you. If makeup and your clothes, all that is good, was what was attracting the real men in this generation, then our parents in the days of old, our mothers in the days of old, probably would have never gotten married. Hallelujah. Some women can't even stand well anymore. They can't walk well anymore. It's like there are stones under their heel. Their toe or the tip of their back should not touch the ground. They have to stand in a certain way. They have to walk in a certain way. Their bum bum has to be in a certain way. Their hands have to be in a certain way. It's like they want to fly. Their toes will literally not touch the ground because they want to catwalk for a man. Because they want to catwalk for that man so as to be seen by men. But they forget that what brings a real husband, child of God, is not catwalking, but it is spiritual networking. What brings a husband is not catwalking, it is spiritual networking and an eye that can see. Look around you as you go out, if you will. You will see many very ugly people out there married to real people. An ugly man getting married to a real wife. An ugly woman are getting married to a real man. Because they knew that it does not just take beauty to have a lasting marriage. I remember a guy a few years ago, and Mama knows about this guy, and he called me. He has been trying to get a wife. No way. He has been trying, and I mean, he had looks. He's better than me, but he was ugly. His looks were better than mine, but he was ugly, if you understand what I mean. So I'm not trying to say I'm better, but I'm saying his looks were better than mine, but he was ugly. Judge that for yourself. And he says, Pastor, no woman wants to get married to me. Now, not that he was ugly, but he had character issue. He will walk around and there will be an Uzziah oozing from him, like my father would say. Uzziah, there will be a smell coming out from him. It's like he has not bathed for days. His teeth were all brown. He has not brushed for days. When he's talking to you, Uzziah is oozing out. So not only that he was ugly, but he had character issue. As a matter of fact, and he said to me, Pastor, it's difficult. I've been trying and I'm getting old. I don't have a child. I don't have a wife. What do I do? And I said, in the name of Jesus, she is coming to you in 2 weeks. Even me, who said it, I just said it and I forgot, just like I always say. I just said and I forgot. I said, the Holy Ghost is, well, our own part is just to pray. We don't answer any prayer. We have never healed anybody. So my own was just to pray. I heard in my spirit, pray for him. And the Holy Ghost said, pray for him. I said, in the name of Jesus, in 2 weeks, we've heard that you've seen testimonies like that here. I said, a lady is coming to you. After about 3 weeks, he called me. Say, Pastor, I have met her. I said, met, because I forgot. I said, met who? I said, I've met my queen. I've met the bone of my bone.
I made the blood of my blood. I still did not understand. I said, made who? Say, Pastor, remember I told you and you prayed. I said, oh. I said, so what happened? Say, I met her in the church. And that pastor, we are planning marriage. As I speak to you now, they are married and they have two children.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Zechariah 4:6. Then he answered and spoke unto me, saying, this is the word of the Lord unto Zerubbabel, saying, not by power, not by might, but by my spirit, says the Lord. Child of God, in everything we want to embark on in life, it takes an eye that can see to properly align us where we can receive from God and be victorious daily. I told someone the other day who was trying to correct my English, I said, being successful has nothing to do with eloquence of speech, although all that is good if you want to impress people rather than impressing God. I say, Paul said, I came to you not in the eloquence of speech, but in the power of the Holy Ghost. Have you not seen professors who have all sort of PhDs, but yet cannot pay their house rents? Why? Because they are surrounded with opportunities of promotion or surrounded with enlargement, but their eyes are closed. When I say eyes, I mean spiritual eyes. Many are in churches, child of God, around the world, praying day and night, but surrounded by liars, surrounded by dream killers who are assigned to delay and kill their dreams, but they cannot see them because their spiritual eyes are closed. Many Christians, because of spiritual blindness, they have entered into marriages, they have entered into businesses, they have entered into relationships that are now breaking their head because of spiritual blindness. If you are part of that, I disconnect you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I disconnect you in the name of
Amen.
Jesus. By the power of the Holy Ghost, anywhere you find yourself that is not the plan of God, I disconnect you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
A few years ago, someone came to me for prayers, and I was about to lay my hands on them to pray for them. And suddenly, I saw a queen of the coast behind them. My eyes were open. I saw the queen of the coast behind them. And the queen of the coast was telling me, why do you want to help her? And God told me clearly, rebuke her. Now she came to me for prayers, but they had given her an assignment. Start as soon as I lay my hands on her, power change hands. But as soon as I saw that, I rebuked it. And the Lord told me that even as she was coming, they had placed a mirror, so they are monitoring her even as she's coming. So as soon as I lay my hands on her, the manipulation will be from the camp of the enemy. As soon as I lay my hand, power change hand. The anointing of my life will be gone. But how did I survive that? By an eye that can see. Oh Lord, open my eyes. Oh Lord, open my eyes. Child of God, it is a manipulation and an eye that cannot see that will make a person misbehave. I said that last week, in front of their destiny helper sent from above to help them, and they will use their hands and their mouth to drive good things away from them. Why? Because they cannot see in the realm of the spirit. A few years ago, I'll tell you another story. A lady called me urgently to her house. She said, Pastor, urgently, things are happening here. I am suffering. So I thought it was an emergency. And as ignorant as I was, I said, okay, don't worry. Send me your address. I'll come and pray. It's not now that I call people when I want to pray for people. Sometimes I'll call Pastor David, I'll call Mama. But then I was ignorant. That was the beginning of ministry. I said, send me your address. I said, I'll come. As soon as I entered the car, in fact, I was about to enter the car, I heard a voice, don't go. Sometimes you hear a voice, you want to rebuke. Why? Don't go. Maybe this person is delivered. I'm the only person to deliver them. So this voice telling me, don't go, might be her Goliath fighting her that are trying to stop me from going there. I've seen that so many times. And I wanted to start driving that car. And the Lord just flashed. Sometimes you see an open vision. He flashed an image of what was to happen when I get there. And you know what would have happened? I would not have been able to explain to anyone what happened there. Oh Lord, open my eyes. Oh Lord, open my eyes. And I called her and I said, I cannot make it today. Please, I'll some other day, or you meet me in church, because then I did not have an office. And she was insisting, Pastor, it's really bothering me. Things are happening. I said, don't worry. Anytime I said, let me pray for you online. I said, anytime I see you in the office, I'll pray for you again if you need me to lay my hands on you.
Oh Lord, open my eyes. I remember a man of God. I can't remember the name of this man of God, but my father gave this story. He's a prominent man of God who actually was going out preaching to prostitutes. So he met one of these prostitutes and was trying to convince the prostitute to give his life to Christ. Kept convincing the prostitute, and he said to the prostitute, I want to see you again. So the prostitute gave him an address, and he said to him, come and see me on this particular day. Now this man of God on that day went there with his wife. Thank God for him. Now what happened in that house where the prostitute was? The prostitute was naked. The prostitute was standing on the door naked, and there were cameramen behind the prostitute. There were cameramen behind the prostitute. What was the plan of the prostitute? It was a setup. They appeared the prostitute, set him up, set that man of God up. I think it was Billy Graham. I can't remember. And it's Billy Graham, right? Yes, Billy Graham. And what happened is, as the man was about, when he went there with his wife, what happened was, they wanted the prostitute, she was naked. So as soon as the man opens the door, the prostitute would have drawn him inside, and then the cameraman would have taken pictures. Who would have believed him? Where would he have gone and explained to millions of people that I was not involved? This is a setup. Who will believe you? Even your own pastors will run from you. And what happened is, the woman stood behind, and God flashed an image of what is happening in the house. As soon as he opened the door, the woman ran, the wife ran and held him. And they saw all the cameramen. Luckily for him, that woman did not have access to him. So there was no proof that he did anything wrong. Why? By an eye that was open. Oh Lord, open my eyes. Open my eyes. And this is the problem, child of God, with this modern day Christianity. 95% of Christians around the world can only see with their optical eyes. But their spiritual eyes, which is the most important eye, is covered with scales. Oh Lord, open my eyes. In my previous church, I remember having two incidents in almost a week, or I think a month, and also that I would have died if not of an eye that was open. One day I was going for a Bible course, and it was a Bible seminar, and there was a jacket that I don't like. I don't like that jacket at all. I don't like that jacket. But in my house that time, I had an altar, and I put that jacket by mistake on that altar, a place where I call an altar. And then that morning, normally I wouldn't ask, Lord, what should I wear? It's not that I ask all those questions because of what happened. And that morning, the Holy Ghost told me, wear that jacket. This is not a jacket I want to wear. The Holy Ghost said, wear that jacket. I insisted a bit, and then I finally wore the jacket. And then I took that jacket to that Bible school. And when I got to the Bible school, what happened is, the shutters could not open. The shutters were literally jammed. Those are shutters that they've been opening all through, no problem. But that particular morning, the shutters could not open. And the Holy Ghost told me, the reason why I told you to wear that jacket, because that jacket has been touched. And they did everything, physically, mechanically, technically, the shutters will not open. And the Holy Ghost said, right now, pray. Take your jacket and put it as a contact point on that altar. As naive as I was, I took my jacket, prayed, put it on that shutter, and the shutter opened. The same key lock that could open the altar for almost 1 hour. Suddenly, the altar opened. And what happened is, you know, that kind of a thing. People are saying it's anointed. That's what people want to see. And someone brought food to me, I think the next day or that week, and said, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. And the food was hefty. It was this kind of accident food. It was this kind of food that when you see, you like to eat. The oil was special. The ingredients were special. Everything was special. What they call accident food. And I took that food, I put in the car, and I was driving home. As I was driving home, sir, I heard a voice. Don't eat that food. I almost began to bind. I said, don't eat what this food. Don't eat that. Normally, I don't eat food for people anyway. But just looking at that food, I was like, child, this food. Normally, I don't eat food outside. But I looked at that, child, this food. And the Holy Ghost spoke again. Don't eat that food. I drove for about 20 minutes. From the church to my house was about 30 minutes. I drove for about 15, 20 minutes. Don't eat that food. I got to a place, the voice was so heavy. Take that
food and throw outside. I say, the devil, you're a liar. Not all this meat and this mixed mackerel that I saw in this fish. Now, I don't know if you don't like fish. So I and the Holy Ghost said, take that food and throw outside. And because the voice was that heavy, I took that food and threw outside. Oh Lord, open my eyes. Only God knows what could have happened after I ate that food. Luke 24:31, and their eyes were opened, and they knew him, and he vanished out of their sight. Listen to that. And their eyes were open. So you can only know God if your eyes are open. You can only have an encounter with God if your eyes are open. And their eyes were open, and they knew him. Oh Lord, open my eyes. 2 Kings 6:17. And Elisha prayed, and Elisha prayed, and Elisha prayed and said, Lord, I pray thee, open his eyes that he may see. And the Lord did what? Open his eyes of the young man, and he saw, and behold, the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire round about Elisha's. When your eyes are open, child of God, fear automatically disappears. Oh Lord, open my eyes. I pray for someone watching in the name of Jesus. I ask, oh Lord Jesus, I pray thee, open their spiritual eyes in the name of Jesus. Open their spiritual eyes that they may see in the name of Jesus. Oh Lord, empower someone now and take away that spiritual blindness and dullness in the name of Jesus. I prophesy in the name of Jesus that satanic scales on your eyes is wiped off by the power of the Holy Ghost in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
When you see your divine helpers after now, you will locate them in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I say, when you see your Goliath, you will identify and kick them out in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Oh Lord, open my eyes. So again, we must understand that it is not enough to be anointed. It is not even enough to be born again. You must cry out for an eye that can see. Many Christians around the world have lost great privileges. They have lost great opportunities. Many have lost partners. Many have lost business partners. Many have lost relationships. Many have lost things, threw away the helpers of their destiny because of an eye that cannot see. Many have missed contracts because of spiritual dullness and blindness. But after this, I declare, no more spiritual blindness in the name of Jesus. No more spiritual dullness in the name of Jesus. I prophesy to anyone hearing the sound of my voice, whatever battles your parents, your brothers, your sisters could not win because of spiritual blindness, be empowered now to stand and win in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Be empowered now to stand and win in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I say you will not run away from your Goliath after now in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Child of God, take note. It says that David went towards Goliath after his brothers confronted him. 1 Samuel 17:26-28, as a round up. 1 Samuel 17:26-28. Remember, I said today we'll pray. 1 Samuel 17:26-28. He says, and David spoke to the man that stood by him, saying, look at that, what shall be done to the man that killed Goliath and taken away the reproach? David was not looking at their failure. David was not looking at what happened before. He was not interested. As far as David was concerned, Goliath was already a dead man. As far as David was concerned, as soon as he appeared on the scene, as soon as he appeared on the war front, Goliath was dead.
Amen.
Goliath was dead.
Amen.
Your Goliath are going down after this in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Those who have vowed that you are not moving forward, I declare, by 6 a.m. tomorrow, you will hear the news of them falling down in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
1 Samuel 17:26-28. For who is this uncircumcised Philistine, David is saying, that he should defy what? The armies of the living God. Verse 27. And the people answered him after this manner, saying, so shall it be done to the man that killed him. Verse 28. And Eliab, that's David's elder's brother, heard when he spoke unto the men, and Eliab's anger was kindled against David. Look at that. It tells you that there were confrontation in that family. His anger was kindled against David. He wasn't happy. What is this little boy coming to do here? What is this little boy coming to do here? A battle we have not been able to fight. As little as you are, do you think you'll be able to fight it? And his anger was kindled against David. And he said, why comest thou here? And with whom had thou left those few sheep in the wilderness? I know their pride. Look, he's telling David, sir, I know their pride. And the naughtiness, some version will say the wickedness in your heart. A brother is telling the other brother, you are wicked. I know your pride and the wickedness in your heart. Sir, that speaks of foundational power. That speaks of, that was his brother. So they came from one foundation. The foundation in David's father's house, it had to appear to the brother. And the brother was speaking not because of what he knew, but because of the foundation manipulating him to stop David from confronting the Goliath of the family. And that's the same foundation that stopped them. So it came through him because fear has already killed them. They were hiding like little school girls, scared of a bully. So as far as Goliath was concerned, he has killed them all. But David came with the power of the Holy Ghost and spoke a word and knew that Goliath, today you are going down with all the audacity. And the devil tried to use the brother to stop David from confronting their Goliath. So David asked, what will happen to the person who killed Goliath? But the elder brother said, why did you come? See the hate in the elder brother's speech in verse 28. And Eliab, his elder brother, heard when he spoke unto the men. And Eliab's anger was kindled against him, against David. And he said, why come down here? He said, see the wickedness. He was telling David, see the wickedness in your heart. What does that tell you, child of God? That literally tells us that if you must defeat your Goliath, if you must defeat that strong man in your family, you must first of all defeat the powers from your foundation. You must first of all defeat the powers fighting you from your foundation. Psalms 11:3. If the foundation be destroyed, what will the righteous do? What can the righteous do? The righteous there speaks of you and I. That tells you that you must handle your foundation first if you must experience acceleration in life and in destiny. David's brothers, because of manipulation of their foundation, they tried to discourage David. But the Bible records that David ignored his brother because David knew that what he said was empowered from their foundation. And David stepped forward, the Bible says, to confront his Goliath after the brother tried to discourage him. David was indirectly saying to his brother, brother, don't you see our foundation? Don't you see that in this family nobody gets married? Brother, don't you see that in this family nobody remains on top? Brother, don't you see that in this family no one really has a child? No one has gone to university? No one is rich? Brother, don't you see that in this family no one buys a house? No one is driving a car? Even a camel we don't have. Brother, don't you see that all we have been doing in this family is struggling? Brother, don't you see that we have not been able to cross a particular point in our life? No one has prospered beyond a particular point. Brother, do you like what you see? That's what David was saying. Child of God, look at your family. Do you like what you see in your family? I ask you that question. Do you like what you see in that family? Do you like the patterns you see in that family? Do you like the fact that none in your family has been able to get a billion pounds? It is possible. It is possible. In many families today, child of God, many women and even men cannot get married. And those who are married are fighting battles every day in their marriage. They are now looking for a way out of the marriage. In other families, no one can graduate at university. In other families, many people don't get to a particular age. In other families, everyone is sick of the same disease. In other families, everyone is afflicted. In other families, no one gets a job. In other families, many cannot build a house or buy a car or drive a car. In other families, poverty is the order of the day. Poverty rules. Poverty is a trend in many families. You see people struggling to eat regardless of where they are. Even those who are in Europe, they are struggling. Even those who are in America, they are struggling. Even those who even have a job, they cannot survive. Before the end of the month, there are problems left, right, center, and that money all goes. Many of you looking at me now, money never stays in your hand. Why? Because those foundational powers have shifted and tied those finances. But no more. You have struggled for so long. I came to prophesy to someone hearing the sound of my voice in the name of the resurrected King. I don't care
my child of God, whatever is resisting people in your family, but after now, I see the God of heaven giving you victory in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
After now, what has not worked for you before, it begins to work in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I say this is a new beginning for you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
New testimonies for you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
A new story in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you, my Father. So therefore, child of God, we must understand that there are powers in our father's house, in our mother's house, in our environment that has vowed that you will not have that job, that you will not get married, that you will not fulfill purpose in life, and they want to discourage you from fighting them. You must rise up therefore by the power of the Holy Ghost and begin to confront that thing that puts fear into you. Remember I said the only way to win the spirit of fear, against the spirit of fear, is to confront that thing that puts fear into you. And in 1 Samuel 17 verse 26, and David spoke to the man that stood by him, say, what shall be done to the man that killed this Goliath and taken away the reproach from Israel? For who is this uncircumcised Philistine? David said, what shall be done? So why David's brother stood there looking at how Goliath was armed and how Goliath was big, David saw the reward. I've said already, I want to expand on that a bit. Many Christians fail in life and destiny because they do not look at the reward of Christianity. They forget where they came from. They forget where they are going to. I said last week, I said, in this kingdom, your final destination is heaven.
Amen.
Your final destination is heaven. That is where you are going to. That is where you should focus on. Not on the afflictions of yesterday. Not on the challenges of yesterday. Not on the issues of yesterday. Not on the fights of yesterday. You are looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of your faith. And when you understand this, child of God, you will not be distracted by the loss of the flesh. You will not be distracted by worldly things. Because on judgment day, no one will ask you what car were you driving on earth. No one will ask you how many room house were you living on earth. No one will ask you how much money did you have on earth. No one will say this is a special house for you because you were in parliament. 2 Corinthians 4, 17, 18. It says, for a light affliction, which is bad for a moment, worketh for us what? A far and more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. Verse 18. 2 Corinthians 14, 17, 18. It says, why we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal. That car you are driving is temporal. That house you are living in is temporal. That wife is temporal. Everything you own on earth that is physical is temporal. We've taught here that we go after the things which are eternal. The things which are eternal. The gifts which are eternal. Wisdom. The wisdom of God. The knowledge of God. The understanding of God. Those are things that are eternal. But as the things which are not seen, for the things which are seen are temporal. I like that. But the things which are not seen, what are eternal? You cannot see wisdom. You cannot see knowledge. You cannot see understanding. Those are the things we go for. God himself came down after Solomon sacrificed 5,000 burnt offering. And God said, Solo, what do you want? Solomon, before 5,000 could have finished, he sacrificed another 500. He sacrificed another 500. That was 1,000 burnt sacrifices. And God said, Solomon, what do you want? Solomon did not ask for riches. Solomon did not ask for gold. Solomon did not ask for diamond. Those are all things that are physical. You can touch them with your hand. They are temporal. Solomon asked for wisdom. Wisdom is eternal. And till today, till tomorrow, till Jesus comes, Solomon will be the richest man on earth. Why? Because God said, because you did not ask for riches, I will not only give you wisdom, I will give you so much riches. So child of God, in order to speedily defeat the enemies of your life, you must focus on where you are going. You must focus on where you are going and not where you are at the moment. Where you are is irrelevant. I'll give you an example about boxer. They don't focus on the battles they lost. They focus on the crown that they're about to take.
They focus on the reward that they are about to win. They don't focus on the battles that they did not win. If you are driving to London, I've given this example again and again and again. Sir, even if your car breaks down in Birmingham, you'll look for a way to get to London. It's happened to me once. I was driving to London and a car I bought broke down many years ago, about 12 years ago. And I had to call AA. They towed the car and I still went to London. Because my destination was London. Because I was focused on my destination. I wasn't bothered what was happening in between London and Wolverhampton. On Friday, I said that David won every battle because he went into every battle with a victory mindset, with a generational mindset. And think about it, you are not fighting battles for yourself. You fight battles for your generation. You fight battles so that your children will not fight the same battles. The Bible says David won battles. He won all 66 battles. And when his son Solomon sat on the throne, because David has fought all the battles, his son Solomon had peace on every side. So the battles you are fighting today are the battles that your children will not need to fight. Any battle you refuse to fight today, you'll fight tomorrow. Any battle you refuse to fight today, your children will fight tomorrow. Even if you go and leave it, your children will come and fight it. So fight now. Decide to fight now. 1 Samuel 17:45-47. David said to Goliath, "You come against me with a sword and a spear and a javelin, but I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied." Verse 46. This day, look at what a man is saying to a giant. A man who is 4 feet is talking to a man who is 16 feet, the biggest man that ever lived. This day, the Lord would. He's not doubting his hour. He's not. There's no iota of doubt anywhere. The Lord, who you are, it's this day the Lord will deliver you in my hand. Look at what gives him the audacity? The Lord will deliver you into my hands, and I will strike you down and cut off. That happened before even the audacity on the platform of an eye that can see. The Lord will deliver you into my hands, and I will strike you down and cut off your head. This very day, I will give the carcasses of Goliath's army to the birds, and the wild animals, and the whole world will die. And the whole world will know that there is a God in Israel. All those gathered here will know that it is not by sword or spear that the Lord saves, for the battle is the Lord, and he will give all of you in my hands. A lady said to me many years ago that I'm prophesying by familiar spirit. And I said to her, "Thank you, ma." I said, "If I be a man of God, the world will know that you are the Jezebel spirit." 2 years down the line, exposed. Another one, the same thing. She said to me, "The way you're doing this church, I thought you give me a position." I said, "It's not a Cameroonian church, so you'll not have any position." I said, "Just by asking a position, you'll never have a position. So if you came here for a position, pack your loads and bye bye yo." And she said, "I'll see how this church will prosper after a year." I said, "If I said that before, if I be a man of God, if within now and 5 years, you don't come and apologize, watch." I think last year or last 2 years, she came in church here and she said, "I am sorry." You know why? I believe that an angel was giving her slaps, left, right, center. Amen. When she goes out, affliction. Amen. When she comes in, affliction. She came down here, she kneeled down, said, "Papa, I'm sorry," crying her heart out. In audacity, don't allow someone to tell you, you will see, and you close your mouth. That is an error that we came to correct today. Nobody should go to the hospital and they tell you have HIV and you take that certificate and you go to your... Do you want to paste it on your wall? Is it a calendar? Tear the nonsense. I cannot have HIV. Not in my family. Not in my generation. Not in my time. He said when he created me that my lungs were fine. That my liver was fine. That my blood was purified. HIV is not my portion. Back to sender. You must say it. Say you are defying the armies of the God of Israel. My God, who are you? A small guy that nobody knew, sir. He said, "Today I will give you what? Your head to the bells." Allah, God, Tambiala. You don't understand. what David was doing, the child of God was pushing, putting pressure. That's what Elijah did. The same people that came to arrest John the Baptist and cut off his head, and he never said anything. The same people came to arrest Elijah. Elijah said, if I be a man of God, let fire now, not tomorrow, let it come down and sweep you all. What happened? Literal fire came from heaven and burned them all. You are joking. Audacity. You are putting pressure on the integrity of God. Audacity. No doubt, sometimes I've said, if I be a man of God, you have to have that audacity. You are not a healer. You are not a deliverer. You are a vessel. Many people can't say it because they want to take the glory for the miracle. Audacity. What David was doing, they was putting pressure on the integrity of God, because David saw the end point of Goliath before he stepped forward. I've said already, as soon as David saw that Goliath was already dead, he stepped forward. So it did not matter what the brothers were telling him, he saw it. What you see gives you an advantage over others. And I said on Friday that David knew that any enemy fighting him, regardless of how strong they were literally powerless without the Spirit of God. James 2:26, for as the body without the Spirit is dead. Any man who is not born again, any man who is not in the Spirit, as far as I'm concerned, you are under my pie. Now, one of the many reasons why most Christians still mourn, one of the many reasons why most Christians still fail, one of the reasons why many Christians still complain and fail and are defeated in battles, is because they have not seen the end point of their enemies. We said already, they have not seen the end point of that challenge. Because if you are going for an interview, sir, you should see yourself getting the job. You should see yourself starting the job. You should see yourself preparing. Even before you go for that interview, make sure that you've ironed your shirt that you wear for the first day at the job site. Man, you are putting the integrity of God on that display. I said last time, I said you go for a job interview and you get that, you look at the people who came for the job interview. Oh, you just start praying for them. Say, oh Lord, bless them, because this job is my job. Father, give them another job in Jesus' name. Even heaven will watch you, sir, and heaven will literally be under pressure to give you that job.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
I have had the privilege to counsel so many women, especially who are depressed and worried. And they are depressed, they are worried, and that brings about failure in other areas of their life. Many of them will say, Pastor, I'm getting old, I'm not married. And my question has always been, who told you that you must get married to be successful? Who told you that you must get married to be successful? Apostle Paul was not married, but he was successful. Esther was not married, extremely successful. And Jesus and Messiah was not married. And many of the disciples were not married, but they were very successful. And married is a good thing. Esther was married, sorry. And married is a good thing, child of God. Don't get me wrong. But when you focus, when you put all your energy, child of God, in marriage, when you put all your energy, you are stressing, you are worried, you are anxious because you want to get married, then I'm afraid you will be overwhelmed, you will be stressed, you will be anxious, you will be worried, you will be afraid, and heaven will watch you and do nothing about it. Hebrews 12:2, looking where? Unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of your faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured what? The cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Many people say it's a shame that I'm not married. No, it's not a shame. You have made it a shame, and it's brought about depression, and it's affecting every other area of your life. When you're focused on what you are going through, child of God, now, when you are focused on that challenge, you will be consumed, whether you know it or not, by those problems, and your spiritual eyes may be closed, may be covered, and you won't be able to see the solution when it comes. That will not be your story, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Yes, it is true you had a miscarriage, or you don't even have a child at the moment, but thank God it is not the Holy Ghost that you do not have. That is why when David and the prophets of old were faced with a challenge, God in heaven said what? He said, David, encourage yourself. God did not come and encourage him, sir. David, encourage yourself. And the Bible says, and David encouraged himself in the Lord. God literally said to Paul was crying out to God every day for help with healing.
Paul had an affliction. God said to Paul, Paul, my grace is sufficient. Why did God not come down and heal him? My grace is sufficient. But we live in a yeyetic generation where many Christians will have a challenge, and instead of rising up by the power of the Holy Ghost, when you have the Holy Ghost, you have an advantage. When you have the Holy Ghost, you have an advantage. Instead of rising up by the power of the Holy Ghost, you see them, they are discouraged. You see them, Pastor, I cannot do it again. Pastor, I am tired. Pastor, I am tired. They will cry God a river, as if to say crying is a prescription for answers to prayers. No, sir, no, ma. Many Christians will even tell you that in their family, they cry a lot. That is a normal thing in a family. When we cry, we feel better. No, you don't feel better when you cry. You don't feel better. The problem does not go when you cry. It does not. In fact, you empower the enemy, because the enemy is happy when you cry, sir. Their intention is to make you cry. Their intention is to bring sorrow. So when you cry at the forefront of battle, it is an error that needs to be corrected. If you must know, cry is the plan of the enemy to stop you from fighting your Goliath and the battles of your life. Crying on the altar of prayer is the plan of the enemies to overwhelm you and keep you discouraged and in bondage for long. I pray for you in the name of Jesus. I declare, the last cry you cried is the last cry you ever cry in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
The last cry you cry is the last cry you ever cry in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Child of God, the truth remains that on the journey of your life, God will always show you your end point if you can see, but he will never tell you how you will get there. He will never tell you how you get to your destination. And you will only get there, sir, if you are focused on your destination. You only get there if you can see your destination. If you can see your destination, that is only when you get there. God showed Joseph dreams of where he was taking him to. But God never showed Joseph all what he will face on his way. The persecution, the false accusation from his own brothers, from Potiphar's wife, the prison sentences and the pit. God never showed him this thing, but he showed him where he was going to. God showed Moses where he was going through, but he never showed Moses the Goliath. He never showed Moses the Egyptian. He never showed Moses the battle that he was going to fight. Because God knew that if he told Joseph that he will face battles, normally, as a man will react, he will say, I'm not doing it again. I'm not ready to go through the pit. I'm not ready to go through the prison. I'm not going to be ready to go through the persecution. Joseph would have probably told God, take your dreams, let me remember my simple life. I remember a few years ago, he said to me that he will make me so rich that nations will come and borrow from me. But do I look like I am? No, sir. Will he bring it to pass? Yes, of course, as long as I continue to focus on him. And it is by focusing on the vision that heaven will empower you to stand still no matter the challenges you face on your way to your destination. I prophesy for you hearing the sound of my voice in the name of Jesus. Open your hands wherever you are right now. Open your hands wherever you are right now. Let me put something in those hands in the name of Jesus. I declare, not next week, not next year. I decree, if I be a man of God, for you will believe this week. I declare the remainder of this year, this week, take the key to your liberty in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Take the key to your success in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Take the key to your settlement in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Take the key to that family deliverance in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Take the key to that family prosperity in the
Amen.
Name of Jesus. Shout, I receive it in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I prophesy as I'm commanded in the name of Jesus Christ. To those dry bones in your life, let dry bones rise again in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Let dry bones rise again in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Let dry bones rise again in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I prophesy every strong man in your family still holding what belongs to you, I pull them down by fire, by thunder in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I announce their obituary now in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Let the power in the blood of Jesus set you free and everything that concerns you in the mighty name of
Amen.
Jesus. Thank you, my Father.
Thank you, Jesus.
If you are blessed, thank God for that word that came for today. Father, we just thank you. Father, we just bless you. Father, we just celebrate you. Thank you and thank you and thank you, my Father. Thank you and thank you and thank you, my Father.
Thank you, Master Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen. Amen. Please, you at home, it's time to take the communion because of time. Get your communion. Let's pray and let's break bread in the name of Jesus. Get your communion. Someone online, get your communion. Get the bread. Get water, whatever you have, juice. Get it. It is bread. It is water at the moment. But as we transform it into the blood of Christ and the body of Christ, it becomes the power of God raw in your system. You've seen so many testimonies here where people got healed by the power in the blood of Jesus. Cancers disappeared by the power in the blood of Jesus. New spare parts were replaced. Lungs were replaced. Fresh and fresh by the power in the blood of Jesus. Insanity here was disgrace by the power in the blood of Jesus. HIV vanished. That same thing is happening to you at home. Get the blood of Jesus. Get water if you have. Get bread in your home. As you take of that, as I pray now, things will begin to happen in your life. Testimonies will begin to evolve. Things that have been rejected before, you will receive acceptance this week. Get it now. Get it now. Get it now. This is mine. This is the bread. And this is the wine that I have right now in my hands. I'll pray for it. And I pray for the ones in your house. I declare by the power of the Holy Ghost, that bread, that wine that you have in your heart, let it be sweet. We don't do alcohol here. That bread, that wine in your house, that water, that juice, whatever it is, we transform them in the body of Christ and in the blood of Christ. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, we declare by the power of the Holy Ghost, let the heavenly bodily presence of the Lord begin to enter the body and the blood of Christ right now in the name of Jesus. We declare in the name of Jesus, let the healing power of God right now touch the body and the blood of Christ that is in your hands in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Let deliverance power fall on him now in the name of Jesus. Let restoration power fall on him now in the name of Jesus. Let preservation power fall on him now in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Father, we thank you for the anointing that destroys the yoke right now. In Jesus' name we are praying. Amen. Amen. The Bible says that just shall live by faith. What you now hold in your hand is not bread. What you now hold in your hand is not a water. It's not a drink. It is a body and the blood of Christ. Now we shall pray. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread. Whoever is online and you here, take the bread. He took the bread. After he has blessed it and given thanks, he gave it to the disciples saying, take of this and eat. This is my body that was broken, that is broken for you on the cross of Calvary for the remission of your sins. Do this as often as you can until my coming in remembrance of me. Amen. Take it by faith. Anything that must leave you, let it leave you now. Begin the prayer as you take it. Whatever is in you that needs to go, let it go. Any spare part that you need, let it be given to you now in the name of Jesus. Thank you, my Father. In the same order of event, after they may have taken of the body, Jesus took the cup that represented his blood. After he has blessed and given thanks, he gave it to the disciples saying, take of this and drink. This is my blood of the new covenant that is shed for you on the cross of Calvary for the remission of your sins. He said, do this as often as you can until my coming in remembrance of me. Take it by faith. And so taking it, you are praying. Anything in me that needs to go, let it go. Give it to your children. Anything that needs to go in them, let it go. Anything that needs to disappear, let it disappear. My daughter here was diagnosed somehow with a neck that could not stand. By the blood of Jesus, she is now fine and sound and well. Take it by faith and you are praying. Take it by faith and you are praying. Take it by faith and you are praying. Maso palie kata. Leko kote lakia. Mate salie kotiama. Pray. Whatever needs to leave me now, let it leave me. The Bible says, whatever my heavenly Father has not planted in you shall be uprooted. Whatever needs to leave me now, let it leave me. Whatever is in me that has not been planted by God, let it go. Let it go now in the name of Jesus. Anything in me not planted by God, let it go. Let it go. Every sickness in me, by the power in the blood of Jesus, let it be swallowed up right now. 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 Every negative medical report, by the power in the blood of Jesus, let it be swallowed up right now. Let it be swallowed up right now. In the mighty name of Jesus. Are you praying that prayer? Let him hear your voice. 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 Maso palia. Leke kete mayala. Male. Whatever is in me that is not of God. Whatever has not been planted by God in me. Be uprooted by the power and the blood of Jesus. The Bible says the blood of Jesus speaketh a better word than the blood of Abel. Let it be uprooted. Every sickness die. Every sickness die. By the power and the blood of Jesus. Mako kote mayala. Lekekete mayakata. Malo kapiala kata. Father, we thank you. Lord, we celebrate you. Lord, we rejoice you. In Jesus' name we are praying. Amen. We shall take two prayers and then we shall go. Luke 19:27. Before I read that, think about it. The secret to David's victory was because David understood that the way forward was not to run away from God when he was afflicted. David understood that the way forward, the victories was always to go to God. Whether in affliction, whether in discouragement, David always went to God. David never ran away from God. So he went to God in prayers at all times. In poverty, in plenty, in abundance, David knew that the secret to go on top and remain on top was by prayer. We have prayer ministry. Luke 19:27. But those my enemies, look at that, which will not that I should reign over them. My enemies, which will not that I should reign over them, bring them hither and slay them before me. So literally that tells you, child of God, that it is the will of God for you and I to reign in every area of our life. But also it tells you that there are enemies that have vowed that you will not reign, what we have been teaching today. There are enemies of progress that has vowed that you will not get that job, that has vowed that you will not get that finances that is owed you. And it takes consistent prayer to reign in life. Look at Revelation 1:5-6. And from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, and the first begotten of the dead, and the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his blood. Verse 6, and had made us kings. Look at that. Kings and priests unto God and his Father. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Who has made us what? Kings. So you are not maybe a king, sir. You are a king as far as heaven is concerned. He said you are a royal priesthood. You are a holy. If you don't carry that mentality, you'll be broke on earth. Heaven will watch you die and do nothing about it. You are a king. As you walk out today, walk like a king. As you walk out today, carry that mentality. I cannot fail because I'm a royal. He has ordained me to be a priest. He has ordained me to be a king. Kings don't fail. Kings sit on royal seats. Yes. Anywhere a king sit is a throne. Amen. Anywhere a king sit is what? A throne. The prayer is, Father, in the name of Jesus.
Father, in the name of Jesus.
I decree and I declare.
I decree and I declare.
Whatever powers that are fighting my reigning in life,
in
ministry, in finances, in marriage,
in business,
in my career, wherever they are, cast fire. Open your mouth and pray that prayer. Any power that is fighting my reigning in life, any power that is fighting my reigning in marriage, you are meant to reign in marriage. You are meant to run in business.
My reign in my ministry and business.
Makokote mayagata. Father, empower them as they pray to reign in every area of their life. Empower them, O Lord. I refuse to be a reproach to heaven. Any power of darkness that is fighting my reign in life, in ministry, in my finances, in my marriage, in my business, in my career, let those powers cast fire. Let those powers cast fire. Let those powers cast fire. In the name of Jesus. Are you praying that prayer? Is he hearing your voice? Pray. Any power that is stopping my reigning in life.
In the power, oh Lord, that is
no matter their rank, no matter their level, no matter their office, let them catch fire. Any power that is stopping my children from reading, any power that is stopping my finances from rising, let them catch
fire.
No matter their rank, no matter their level, no matter their office, no matter their area, let them catch fire. Let them catch fire. Let them catch fire.
Yes, Lord.
Let them catch fire.
Holy Ghost,
thank you, my Father.
Holy Ghost,
thank you, my Father.
Jesus Christ,
in Jesus' name we are praying. Again, he says, look at the same Luke 19:27. But those my enemies, which will not that I should reign over them, bring them. Bring them, he says. It means bring them and expose them. He says, bring them, expose them, let them confess, and then slay them. Let them confess and then strain them. Have you ever asked yourself why God did not just slain them? He said, bring them, let them be exposed first.
Yes.
Because sometimes you need your enemies to confess so that you know they'll give you some secrets. You know what next prayer point to take.
That's right.
You need your enemies to confess. I do not know about you, but I don't want my enemies to die silently without confessing. Because if they don't confess, child of God, and if they accuse me falsely, sir, it will take years for people to believe that you are right. So those 2-3 years that you are suffering, people will think that you are a liar. People will think the saint of Jesus that you are operating by the prince of whatever they call him, by the prince of the devil. They said to Jesus that you are prophesying by the prince, just as they said to me, you are prophesying by the prince of the devil. It will take years. So your enemy should confess and then slay them. Because when they confess, they will vindicate you. Because if they don't confess and they die, people will still believe that you are a witch, even though you are not. People will still believe that you did what you did not do. We shall pray, Father, in the name of Jesus.
Father, in the name of
Jesus. Expose the accusers of my destiny.
Expose the accusers of my
destiny. Who accuse me day and night?
Who accuse me?
Say,
whosoever.
That is fighting my royalty.
Fighting my
let life. Them be exposed.
Let them be exposed.
Let them confess.
Let them confess.
In the name of Jesus. Open your mouth and pray that prayer. Let them be exposed. Let them be exposed. Let them be exposed. Father, I did nothing wrong. Vindicate me from the accusers of my destiny. I am not a witch. I am not a liar. I am not operating by a demon. Let them be exposed.
Lord, let them
pray that prayer. Let them be exposed.
Let them be exposed.
Let them be exposed. Let them confess. Let them confess. Vindicate me, O Lord. Vindicate me, O Lord. Vindicate me, O Lord. Vindicate my family. Vindicate my mother. Vindicate my father. Vindicate my brother. Vindicate my sister. Vindicate my business. Open your mouth and pray. Many of you have businesses. Nobody is coming there because they've told a lie about you. They said you buy things from the water spirit. Open your mouth and pray.
In my family, vindicate me, Lord.
Let them confess. 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 Oh Lord, 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 let them confess. Let them confess, Lord. Let them confess, Lord. Let them confess, Lord. Thank you, my Father.
Thank you, my Father.
In Jesus' name we are praying.
Amen.
Many people are doing business, no customer. It's not that their goods are not good. Someone has gone ahead and said their goods are second-hand goods, whereas their goods are real goods. Someone has gone ahead and is accusing them that they probably bought those goods from the Marine Kingdom. Someone has gone ahead and is messing around with their business. He's talking again. The devil that accuses them day and night. They need to confess. This month, the remainder of this year, whoever has fought you, whoever has accused you wrongly, they will confess in the name
Amen.
Of Jesus. Last prayer and we go. Luke 19:27, the last part of that. So there are three prayers on that. And he says, after they confess, he says, bring them and slay them. My God. Bring them and do what? And slay them. The prayer is this. Where is the Lord God of Elijah? Pray that prayer. Say, Father, in the name of Jesus.
Father, in the name of
where is the Lord God of Elijah?
The Elijah.
God that answered by fire.
As
you expose my enemies.
Oh Lord.
Bring them and slay them. Open your mouth and pray that prayer. As you expose my enemies. Bring them and slay them.
Bring them and
bring them and slay them.
Bring them and slay them, Lord.
Bring them and slay them. Bring them and slay them. Hey, are you praying? Is he hearing your voice? Forget about your makeup. Is he hearing your voice? As you expose them, bring them, slay them. Bring them, slay them. As you expose them, bring them, slay them. As you expose them, bring them, slay them. As you expose them, open your mouth and pray that prayer. Put an end to the agendas. You said in Job 5:12 that you disappointed the rest of the country so that their hearts will not perform the enterprise. As you expose them, slay them.
Perform the enterprise.
Make, do your hand like this, like a sword. Do your hand like this, like a sword. As you expose them, slay them. I take up the sword of Allah. Slay them. Slay them with your sword. Holy God, sword. Holy God, sword, slay them. Holy God, sword, slay them. Holy God, sword, slay them. The familiar spirit in my family. Tell us, Lord, I will not move forward.
Yes, Lord. Evil conspiracies.
And guess you expose them, send them.
Wherever, Lord.
As you expose them, send them.
And physically.
As you expose them, send them.
As you expose them, send them.
As you expose them, send them.
Lord,
as you expose them, send them. As you expose them, send them.
I expose them and send them.
Thank you, and thank you, and thank you.
By the sword of the Spirit.
In Jesus' mighty name we are praying.
Amen.
And this is a confidence we have in him, that whatever we ask of him according to his will, we know that he has answered. We are not just prayers by our head. We've given you Bible verses, so it is legit for you to pray those prayers. And because it is the will of God, answers are coming. If you believe that, thank him for answer prayers. Open your mouth. Thank him. Thank Master Jesus. Thank the Rock of Ages.
Thank
the King of Kings. We return all the glory to you, O Lord. Not by power, not by might. What a mighty God we serve. All powers belong to our God. Magnify the King of Kings. Glorify the name of the Lord. Exhort him. Exhort him. That manager that has fought through this week, this year, God is answering you. God has heard your prayer. Thank you and thank you, my Father. You alone are worthy, Lord. In Jesus' name we are praying. In Jesus' name we are giving thanks. Open your Bible, Ezekiel 37:7-10. Take your Bible in your hands. Ezekiel 37:7-10. I round up with this and we go. So I prophesy as I was commanded. And as I prophesy, it says what? It says there was a noise. That's a man prophesying on dry bones. Do you believe that those bones can rise again?
Yes,
yes, sir. He said, as I prophesy, as I spoke it, there was a knock on dry bones, on bones that have been dead for how many years, we don't know. But he spoke to the dry bones. He said, I prophesy. And when he prophesied, there was a noise. And behold, a shaking. And the bones came together. Bones to his bones. And when I beheld, lo, he was surprised, sir. That flesh begins to come on the bone. I don't know about you. Flesh begin to come on the bone.
Yes, Lord.
And amen. The bone, the Bible says,
amen.
And the bone lived.
Yes.
So I prophesy as he commanded me.
Yes.
In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. If I be a man of God,
yes, Lord.
He said the flesh came upon the dry bones.
Yes.
After now, if you are not married, you will not just marry, but I decree and I declare that you married a man with flesh in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I prophesy, after now, you will not just have a permanent job, you have a job with flesh in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I prophesy that you will not just get a house, but you will get a house with flesh in the name of
Amen.
Jesus. Those finances that has been hanging in the air all these years, you will not just get those finances, but you will get them with interest in the name of Jesus. That immigration breakthrough that you have been looking forward to all these years, you are not just getting it this week, you will get it with compensation in the name of Jesus. I command right now, whatever you are trusting God for, those long awaited testimonies, let them be released now in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I decree and I declare by the power of the Holy Ghost, every door that will close against you, I command that door to open right now in the name of Jesus. I command financial door to open in the name of Jesus. I command immigration doors to open in the name of Jesus. I command marital doors to open in the name of Jesus. I command job doors to open in the name of Jesus. I command perfect health doors to open in the name of Jesus. Finally, I declare and I declare, by July 15, let your testimony show up in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I say, let your testimony manifest in the name
Amen.
Of Jesus. Let it happen in your life in the name of
Amen.
Jesus. I declare, declare in your family, like Esther, you'll be the one to break records in the name of
Amen.
Jesus.
Amen.
I say you are breaking records in the name of Jesus. You are breaking records in the name of Jesus. You are breaking records in the name of Jesus. What no one will ever do in your family, I send you forth. Go and do it in the name of Jesus. Go and do it in the name of Jesus. Whoever could not go to university in your family, go and do it in the name of Jesus. Wherever they said you could not cross, by this encounter, I push you there in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Any line they have placed that you could not cross, I push you beyond that line in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
If your amen is not a shout, hallelujah. Shout fire. Shout fire. Shout fire. Shout fire. Fire, fire, fire. Come on, it is done. Thank God. Celebrate Jesus. Father, we just thank you. Lord, we celebrate you. Lord, we rejoice you. Thank you and thank you and thank you. In Jesus' name, we have given thanks. Amen. Mark always the declaration that I make. Most of the testimonies here are coming from declaration. And I believe that this week, your testimony will manifest speedily in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Uncommon favor is coming to someone in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I see three people here this week. Financial blessings in the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
Oh my God, I see three people. Financial favor in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Listen to me very clearly. It will come from unexpected quarters in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Financial favor in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
At that job site, when they are looking for someone to favor, may it be your name sounding in their ears in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you, my Father. It is done in Jesus' name.
Amen.
The next service is on Thursday, midweek service, and then Friday, prophetic end time mystery service. Please don't hide your testimonies. Every time you give us a testimony, we pray and we pray a prayer of perfection. I've said it again, I'm always saying it. Even Jesus wanted them to come back and give a testimony. And when only one came, he asked them, where are the other nine? And he said, because you alone came, let your testimony be whole. And every area of his life was whole. The others left, they may have got their healing, but they were suffering in other areas of their life. But the one who came back and said, thank you, Master, got a healing, and every other area of his life was made whole. It's very important. Join us again in our next service. Please don't forget. Tomorrow, we also, for those of you online who want to pray, we have a prayer line Mondays to Wednesdays where we pray midnight prayers, warfare prayers. The violent, the Bible says, take it by force. If there's a man to pray, there is a God to answer. We love you all at Word and Fire Ministry. We cannot wait to see you again. We continue to stand with you and your families in prayers daily. Please, we love you. See you again. God bless you. Let's share the grace. May the grace of our Lord Jesus,
Lord Jesus Christ,
the love of God, and the sweet fellowship be with us now and forevermore. Amen. Surely God's goodness and mercy shall follow all the days of our life, and we shall dwell in the presence of the Lord forever and ever. Amen. Baba yo. God bless you. Please share to someone who is not here. Share, bless someone. I will receive a lot of testimonies from people who watch after. Share, bless someone. Bye bye. We love you so much. God bless you. Baba yo.